This is what I'm going to call mini lecture one in our flipped classroom format. We're going to cover night, sections 1-1, 1-2, and 1-3. And when I say cover, I don't mean I'm going to tell you everything in 1-1, 1-2, and 1-3. I'm going to give you the highlights, and then you're going to have to go and study 1-1, 1-2, and 1-3, and you're going to have to do the little sidebars and the think about this boxes until you sort of feel like you're ready to come do problems on 1-1, 1-2, and 1-3. And in class, we're going to do problems that that utilize the theory here in 1-1, 1-2, and 1-3. Well, then maybe after you struggle with the problem some, you might even go back to the textbook and this mini lecture and see if it makes more sense the second time around. Would be shocked if it makes complete sense the first time around. Already these concepts, even in section 1-1, 1-2, and 1-3, are very tricky concepts. Section 1-1 seems intuitive. It is pretty intuitive because all of you have seen videos and all of you have seen time-lapse videos and the kinds of things that are on page 3 of Night. So if you take a video, and what is a video? It's just a bunch of successive frames of the same thing. So it's a bunch of equally spaced in time pictures of some scene. So for example, here's a ball. This is from Night's page 3. Here's a video of a ball that starts down here in the lower left-hand part of the picture, and then maybe a fraction of a second later, like 0.1 second later, it's here. Okay, it's our nice little ball. And then 0.1 second later, it's still going up, but maybe not as much. Now it's here. And then 0.1 second after that, it's still going up, but now really noticeably less amount. And 0.1 second after that, it started its way back down. And 0.1 second after that, it's starting to pick up speed on its way down. And finally, at the last, before it leaves the frame, 0.1 second after that, it's really starting to pick up speed on its way down. If you take all 7 of those images and you sort of slap them into one image, that's a motion diagram. So Knight has some really many, multiple really nice examples of a motion diagram, and I'd encourage you to look at the examples at the bottom of page 3 and to the stop to think box at the top of page 4. I'm going to move right on to 1.2, but you would do well to stop and pause right now and make sure that you really understand 1.1, even if it seems pretty easy. 1.2, models and modeling. You notice how I drew a little ball here with a little X or a little squiggle inside the ball. That took me just a little extra time. So one of the shorthands that physicists use all the time, which may or may not be a good thing, depends on the circumstances, one of the shorthands that physicists use is instead of drawing the ball over and over again, or the car over and over again, or the skateboard over and over again, or the dancer over and over again, you just draw a dot. And you pretend this ball is just this little tiny thing with no shape. It's just a kind of a spot, as if the ball has been compressed into a very small space. And you just draw the dot and you say, that represents the ball. And then, in this motion diagram, the ball was up there. And then, 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 the ball was getting really going on its way back down. So, we can draw objects as if they're just dots. And we call those dots particles. And sometimes that's a good thing, and sometimes That makes a mess of the problem that you're originally trying to solve. It depends on the problem. But we're going to start with the absolute simplest case and hope that it doesn't make much difference to imagine that this ball is just a tiny dot of a ball. Go ahead and read 1-2 and do the stop to think 1.2. And then resume once you've waded your way through that. So far, this stuff seems super intuitive, possibly, and possibly it is. So let's go on to 1-3, which is things are going to get a little trickier. If I have a motion diagram, which was this video that I've captured and then plastered these 7 frames together, one of the things I could do is say is try to characterize, well, where was this ball at any given time? And to do that, I have to set up a coordinate system. I can set up my coordinate system anywhere I like. See this dot right here? We call that the origin of the coordinate system. That's where the axes cross. This is usually, this horizontal axis is usually the x-axis, and this vertical axis is usually the y-axis. And I can put the origin anywhere I like. I could have put it here. I could even have done something completely wacky. Like I could have turned the coordinate system some. That would be pretty wacky, especially this early in the course. And I could even do something wackier, like I could say, oh, that's the x-axis, and now this is the y-axis. Oh boy. Let's not do all that, okay? Let's imagine the nicest, simplest case where this is the x-axis and this is the y-axis. Now I want to be able to specify where this ball was when that first image was taken. And what you'll see is this ball has a distance in this direction, and this ball has, if I continue the line over to the axis, a distance in this direction. And to me, that looks like about 30 centimeters. And that looks like about 20 centimeters. So I can specify where the ball is with two numbers, 30 centimeters and 20 centimeters. I can't add those numbers together and get some other number, like 50 centimeters, because then I'd lose the fact that, well, if that 50 comes from 40 and 10, or did that 50 come from 30 plus 20? If I add them together, I've got something meaningless. I need these two numbers to say where that point is. And in fact, if this ball weren't stuck on this two-dimensional board, I'd even need a third number, which says how far it is in this direction. But for the moment here, since this ball seems to be stuck in this board that I've drawn it on, it seems like I need two numbers to say where the ball is. I also need to say, and one more number, which says when it was at this point, and when it was at that point, and when it was at that point, and when it was at that point. And let's say I started my video at, maybe I started a stopwatch, and then the video started 25 seconds into the sweep of the stopwatch hand, and then this would be then at t equals 25.0 seconds. And then I said these frames were 1/10 of a second apart, so this would be at t equals 25.1 seconds. This would be at t equals 25.2 seconds, 25.3, 25.4, 25.6, 0. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, t equals 25.6 seconds is our final time. And its final position over here, if I extend this line down and that line across, it looks like it was at about x equals 60 centimeters, and it was back down to about y equals 21 centimeters. Okay, for sake of space, I'm going to erase that for a moment. The way we write that is we say, for example, at time t6, the particle was at r6, and we write it with a vector symbol over it. This is a symbol. It says the r at time 6 was not just a number, it was two numbers. And those two numbers were x equals 60 cm, y equals 21 cm. And we say, because we need both of those numbers, we say that this is a vector. If we only needed one number to say it where it was, then I guess we could call it a scalar. But we need two. In three dimensions, we need three. And the common way of writing this, by the way, is with parens, so you don't have to write all this x equals y equals all over and over again. X equals 60 centimeters, y equals 21 centimeters, is usually written as what we call an ordered pair. Or a triple if we were in three dimensions. This is a great example of a vector. Okay. I want you to go back now with that introduction and see if you can work through the material on pages 6, 7, 8 and understand a variety of things. In addition to understanding the concept of a vector, you're going to need to understand the concept of the difference between two vectors, and then we call that the displacement. So if we have a vector r6 and we have a vector r5, which was the position of the particle just before this, then we can talk about the difference between r5 and r6. And we write that. We call that r5-6, and we write r5-6 is equal to r6 minus r5. And we draw it like this. I'm going to draw my motion diagram again. I have the particle where it was at time 5, and I have the particle where it was at time 6. I draw my coordinate system again. I draw the vector that represents the distance from the origin, distance and direction from the origin to the particle at time 5. And I draw another vector that represents the distance from the particle to the origin at time 6. This is r5. This is r6, and this has the interpretation of being r5-6. Well, that's a lot of concepts, and it's at least 10 minutes of material. In the first day's class, we'll see how much of this we can turn into problem-solving ability. Thank you very much.